Netflix has cashed in on the Hallmark / Lifetime movie strategy of churning out holiday movie after holiday movie on very little budget and, frankly, very little romantic chemistry, and also a whole lot of Hobby Lobby decorations and fake snow. And throughout this transformation from laggard to leader in the low-budget holiday rom-com realm, there hath emerged one leader, one ultimate fighter, one ring to rule them all. Vanessa Vanessa Hudgens. Yes, the Vanessa High School Musical Hudgens has absolutely dominated the world of the low-budget holiday rom-com. And you won't believe what happens next. To this day, Vanessa Hudgens is f***ing crushing it, y'all. Vanessa Hudgens has acted in and produced up to 4 movies. Actually, I think she's only produced 1 or 2. I think she's only produced 2. But she's been in 4, okay? She has been the lead, the hot, sexy lead. Which, by the way, Vanessa Hudgens, congratulations on your recent marriage. Number 1, we have The Princess Switch in 2018, in which she plays 2 different non-twins, but they're twins. Like, they look like twins, but I don't think they're actually twins. I think they're like cousins or something. Whatever, go with it. We meet Stacy DeNovo, who is a local baker, and she works with a super hot best friend named Kevin. They enter into a prestigious baking competition in the country of Belgravia. She ends up running into the Duchess of Montanaro, Lady Margaret Delacour, who for some reason looks exactly like Stacy. Lady Margaret asks her to switch because she's supposed to be getting married to this like really uptight Crown Prince Edward of Belgravia, and she needs a break, bitch. So they learn how to become each other. And I also just have to point out Vanessa Hudgens' incredible accent as Lady Margaret Delacour.
Lady Margaret Delacour, Duchess of Montanaro. I think we were destined to run into each other.
Anyway, it's like a real parent trap, except that they're not actually sisters. They're just distantly related and look exactly the same because that's how genetics work. And then they switch, and then like hijinks happen. So obviously Stacy falls in love with Prince Edward. Margaret falls in love with Kevin, except that the last two, Margaret and Kevin, do not end up together at the end. They end up deciding that long distance is too much, and so they break up. Prince Edward proposes to Stacy and they decide to get married. And so like a year later, they get married. And then when they throw the bouquet, Lady Margaret catches it. So what's gonna happen next? Then number 2, we have The Night Before Christmas. Do you get it? The night. Actually, this one was a pretty clever title. And I enjoyed watching this movie. It was an okay movie. And she looked beautiful because she's always beautiful because it's Vanessa Hudgens, bitch. So actually, Vanessa Hudgens did produce this one. So that means that she's produced 3 out of the 4 Christmas movies that she's been in. So we got a girl boss on our hands, y'all. This one is about a medieval knight that gets thrown into the future and almost run over by Vanessa Hudgens. And actually in this one, he's pretty hot and has really good charisma, and they both have pretty good chemistry from what I remember. I do need to read the reason why he gets thrown into the future straight off of the wiki, because this is wild. Okay, so he and his brother go hawking. They have an annual Christmas hawking competition. They split up to try to catch the hawk. So Cole goes to the woods. He encounters an unnamed old crone whom he offers to escort to a shelter. She thanks him for his kindness and tells him that she will magically send him to faraway lands on a quest and see things like flying steel dragons and horses and magic boxes that make merry. Those are televisions. He gets thrown into the future. At the same time, Vanessa Hudgens, who is a high school teacher who's disillusioned by love, so she decides to take her niece to the Christmas castle's opening, which is like this faux medieval looking thing. That's the time when Cole gets thrown into the future, and then he's like in the middle of the street, and then Vanessa Hudgens hits him with her car. She takes him to the hospital. They say that he has amnesia, but that he believes that he's a medieval knight, and they're all like, oh, that's so silly. That could never happen. And then for some reason, she takes him home with her. I know that they gave us a reason in the film. I don't remember what it was, but I do remember at the time being like, this is too thin of a reason. This is a bizarre thing to do. Like, you would never just take this stranger home, but I guess he's hot, so she did it anyway. So she lets him stay in her guest house until he recalls his memory. And then in the meantime, oh my God, he's come out half naked, and she realizes he's hot, and then they start to fall in love. He ends up helping her with like some nonprofit event or something. I don't know. Something boring. And then they kiss underneath the mistletoe. And then that apparently is the end of his quest because his medallion lights up blue and it shoots him back into the past. He realizes he's in love and that he needs to get back to his true love. So he runs back into the woods to find the crone again. The crone sends him back to the present and then they get married, I guess. And apparently he like brings his horse back with him this time. So I gotta read this. So the two mount Sherwin, which is the name of his horse, and ride around the castle admired by onlookers.
Then number three at 2020, we have the princess switched again. They switched again, you guys. Again. And this was the one that really turned me on to the whole Vanessa Hudgens cinematic universe that's blowing up. I have been wanting to do this video since 2020. And let me tell you, I don't smoke weed anymore. I have talked about this. You can go see it in my other video. But at this time during 2020, as the world crumpled down around me, I was joyously getting high as fuck on my couch and watching The Princess Switch switched again. Even though I had not seen The Princess Switch, number one, but I jumped in wholeheartedly. And let me tell you, I had a blast. Almost as much of a blast as Vanessa Hudgens was having playing the third twin, who's not a twin, who's like a distant cousin or something, but they all look exactly alike because that's how inbreeding works. The royalty is just flush with it. Look up hemophilia, czars and whatever. Yeah, it's like a whole thing. You should Google it. Anyway, this is another one that I have to read straight off of the wiki because this is so complicated. Okay, the current state, you know what? It actually doesn't matter. Everybody has to gather back in Belgravia. You don't need to know why. Somebody's getting coronated and it's Margaret because randomly the prince, which the wiki says Howard, but I'm pretty sure it's Edward. Who is Prince Howard? All you need to know, everybody's back in Belgravia. Stacy is now the princess of Belgravia. So I guess she's married now to Prince Edward. Margaret, who was the Lady Margaret, is still single because she and Kevin again had broken up at the end of the last movie because of the long distancing. But Kevin's miserable. He's got like a beard. That's how you can tell that he's miserable. Everything gets completely disrupted by Lady Fiona Pembroke, who is the best part of this movie, Margaret's cousin. And this is the one where Vanessa is having the time of her life. She is sassy. She is evil. She is selfish. And she has a plan, you guys, to pretend to be the Lady Margaret because they look exactly alike for no reason that's never explained. And then, okay, this is so stupid. So she's gonna take Margaret's place, but only long enough to get crowned queen and then clean out the royal treasury and then peace out. I don't know why she wouldn't just like, I don't know, kill Margaret, take the throne. Although I guess that would require responsibility and she probably doesn't want that. Our girlie can't be tied down, okay? And then this part I have to read straight off the wiki because it didn't even make sense to me when I was watching it. Stacy decides that the only way to fix things, because Kevin and Margaret are not getting together, the only way to fix things is for her and Margaret to switch identities again so that she and Kevin can have the afternoon to themselves while Stacy takes care of Margaret's schedule. Okay, this is so dumb. Anyway, so while they're switched, the little hench people that are also the best part of this movie that belong to Fiona, they kidnap Stacy thinking that she's Margaret and then lock her up in like the dilapidated Pembroke Manor. Either way, obviously the plan comes all tumbling down. Stacy gets out, I guess, and then she and Margaret arrive just in time to expose Fiona as an imposter. And then, of course, everybody except for Fiona lives happily ever after. Obviously, Margaret and Kevin get together, blah, blah, blah. Margaret becomes queen. She gets crowned queen of Montanaro. Oh my God, you know what I just realized? Montanaro and Belgravia are two different countries. It took me doing a YouTube video about this stupid series to understand that we are covering two separate countries between the first and second films. So in the first film, they go to Belgravia, which I guess is going to be Prince Edward's country. And then Montanaro, which Margaret is now queen of, is a different country. Wow. World building. In 2021, 4 years after the original princess switch, we switched again, bitches. Yeah, you didn't think that we were gonna leave it just at once or twice. No, this time we're gonna switch three different princesses. That's right. The Princess Switch 3, Romancing the Star.
Which also, that's a play off of this better movie called Romancing the Stone, which you should absolutely watch. It's incredible. There's definitely some moments that I feel like don't really hold up from the 80s, but overall, solid movie. Solid movie. You should watch that instead of watching this. Because I'm going to take you through this. Okay. So in the third one, I got really excited because this one's pretty much all about Fiona. In fact, we barely see Margaret and Stacy and then the other two guys. Like, I'm pretty sure those guys just had like one single shoot day. Somebody steals this Hobby Lobby looking ass star from the Treasury because it was getting loaned to them by, I guess, the Vatican. Their costumes are like straight up Halloween store. Like, they look cheap, and my TV's 15 years old, so if it looks cheap on that TV, oh my god. The star gets stolen. Margaret and Stacy are like, oh no, like the Vatican or whoever is completely dependent on us having this star for this random plot point. They have to like have it for an event or something, and it's gonna be really bad, I guess, if they don't. Except that they never actually like hammer home how important it is or like what the stakes are. They just kind of jump from scene to scene and expect you to kind of be on for the ride, but there's like no ride. You know, like those little trains that are outside the zoo that go so slow, like maybe 1 mile an hour, that are like for toddlers? Like, that's the ride that they're expecting you to jump on. So they cook up this ridiculous plan where they're like, you know what, in order to get this star back, we need a thief. And the biggest thief that we know is Fiona. And so they break her out of her, she's like in a convent. Like, she's not in jail, she's in a convent. Okay. The rich really are not like us. And so they get her out of the convent, and then they're like, help us steal this star back, and then you don't have to go back to the convent, I guess is the deal they give her. And so then she is like, well, you know who we need? We need hot guy number three, whose name I can't remember because he's also really boring. And he used to be Interpol. And my friend who was watching this with me had to remind me of this, because this whole movie, I thought he was a thief, because when they go to his house, he's got like these crazy pieces of technology. And then like, I think a pinball machine, like a bachelor's paradise, and not bachelor in paradise, but like a bachelor's paradise. I could have sworn that he was a thief because he's speaking like all these thief terms, and then like he seems to have like these shady connections and whatnot, and like understands how like thieving works. But then like three quarters of the way through, I was like, oh, I thought he was a thief. And then my friend who was watching it with me was like, no, he's Interpol, he's been Interpol the whole time, but he got kicked out because he stole a diamond. So then we were like, oh, maybe he was like trying to take the fall for Fiona. But nope. This happens a lot actually in this film, where they set up like a plot point, or what you think is going to be a plot point, and then nothing happens. So there's this where like he actually, I guess, was just a bad guy who like stole a diamond while he worked for Interpol. But then for the rest of the movie, he's like a good guy and we're supposed to always trust him. And then even at the end, he does kind of screw her over, because like they do this whole Mission Impossible thing to get the star back. And then he steals the star from Fiona, and then she's like super disappointed. But then it turns out that he was just holding it hostage to force her to meet up with her estranged mother, which I have to talk about this. Don't do that. Like, for a very good reason, Fiona has not spoken to her mother, because they give us this back, like this sad little backstory where she and hot guy number three were like essentially orphans together, or like at this boarding school together as little kids. And that's how they became best friends, because they would spend Christmas with each other and nobody else. Like, there's nobody else at the school, no other teachers, no nothing, just these two children in a cafeteria alone. Her mother was never there. Like, her mother just straight up leaves every time, even though Fiona's crying and like wants her to stay. It was like heartless mother, right? Emotionally distant mother. And so for that reason, Fiona does not speak to her. She has no contact with her mother. And like, yeah, you get to set a boundary. That's how boundaries work. And the whole movie, hot guy number three is like, no, you should really talk to her. Like, you should talk to her. The whole time I'm like, well, shut up, because you're not the one in the relationship. You're allowed to have your opinion, but you don't get a say in who's no contact or not. I could have just let it go at that. But then he steals the star to force her to meet up with him at their old school, where there's like still kids running around, by the way, and these adults are just randomly walking in, and he's forcing her to meet with her mom, who's there. That made me so angry. Because even though, obviously, plot armor, they work it out, and then she and the guy live like happily ever after, and then her mom is back in her life, but like, that's not how real life works. And I really don't think that it's okay, even like in a cheesy Netflix holiday movie, to make people think that that's okay by having that be like a positive plot. because it's not. If you're ever considering forcing somebody to confront the parent that they're no contact with or a person that they're no contact with, maybe don't do that. Maybe just don't, because you're not a therapist. And the only person who gets to decide whether or not they're going to meet up with that person again is the person who has set the boundary. So fuck off, hot guy number three. Ugh. Where was I? Okay, here's the thing. I can't talk about this movie without rewriting it into a better movie. From the very beginning, she goes to ask his help. They're saying words like there's supposed to be tension between them, but you don't feel any tension. Oh, I don't know that I want to help you. And then there's like no reason why, you know, and there's no reason why she's not dating him because he's clearly in love with her. And that's the thing, is that he's clearly in love with her and wants to be with her from moment one. And he's been pining after her this entire time. So what would have been better is if she had stolen a diamond while he was working for Interpol and she had used his connections to be able to do so. Then he will deliberately take the fall for her because he loves her. But then she walks away, because that's a Fiona thing to do. She'd be like, thanks, bro, I'm out. And then now he's mad. And so that's why they haven't spoken in years. That's why even though they're perfect for each other, they're not together, because she screwed him over after he did her this big solid. And so then now she has to come crawling back to ask his help to get this thing back for her non-twin sisters that she's twins with, to help them out because it's going to help her get out of convent jail. And then now you've got tension. Now you've got her having to convince him to help her. Now you've got them sniping at each other and arguing and almost like a second chance romance / enemies to lovers thing. But no, we don't have that, because Netflix doesn't want you to have any tension whatsoever. No conflict. Because why? Why would you need conflict in a movie? I don't know. The other thing that they don't really follow through on, there's this moment where like he takes her on a date, which is like they're planning a heist. They're planning a heist, and he goes, you know what would be great right now? Let me rent a helicopter to come pick her up on a date that I haven't asked her on. I just show up with a helicopter, and then she gets in with me. And then they go on a date. And then meanwhile, like in one of the very few split second scenes where you see some of the other characters from the previous films, Prince Edward is like, oh, that's going to be dangerous. What with the storm coming in? Because there's, I guess, like a winter storm coming in. And so then you think, oh, this is going to be great, actually. Like they're going to go on this date, but then they're going to get stuck in like a big blizzard or something. And then they're going to have to hole up like in a little cabin. And now like they're stuck having to wait out the storm. And now they have to work out all their problems. You know, it's like a classic trope. But guess what? That doesn't happen at all. He just says that line and then nothing ever comes of it. So they just go on a helicopter date to another town where there's like ice skating, and then they ice skate, and then they like hug and fall on the ice together. And it's supposed to be like fun and romantic, and all I can think of is like, somebody broke something. Have you ever fallen on ice? That sucks. Oh, and here's the other thing that they never follow through on. She and Hawkeye number three go to like this hotel thing where like this hotelier shows up, because for some reason, plot reasons, they've got a lead that says like this guy, this like really rich but like / dangerous guy might be involved, / he and Fiona may have hooked up in the past. I don't know. We never follow up on it. And so she ends up like flirting with him to get an invitation to another party that he's holding. And at this point, I guess they just know that he has the star at his mansion where he's holding this fancy dress party. This is then where we enter into this montage, full Mission Impossible with like lasers and everything, where for some reason, they just have access to his blueprints of his mansion. As we move into this montage of them prepping for this heist, this Mission Impossible heist, which by the way, her two henchmen are back, and again, they're the best parts of the film. They say that this hotelier guy who's a crime boss, this is the other thing that they never follow through on. So they're like, oh, he must have stolen it. You literally never find out why he stole that star. I guess you're just supposed to assume that he's just a rich guy who likes stealing things. So during this montage, I legit never understood why they needed to then switch everybody again, but it's decided that all three of them now need to switch and pretend to be Fiona. So Queen Margaret has to pretend to be Fiona to show up at the party. And then Fiona has to, I guess she's the only one who can do the lasers. And so she has to go do the lasers to get the star. And then while they're gone on the mission, for some reason, and it's like Christmas Eve or something, and then that's when the judges of the convent, I guess, decide to hold a hearing to like decide whether or not she's good enough morally to leave the convent, I guess. But obviously she's not there, and the nun is going to get in trouble for letting her out early to like do this favor for Queen Margaret. So Stacy then has to pretend to be Fiona. So she goes to the convent. Obviously Stacy's like a good person, so she's able to pretend to be Fiona and then like pretend to be like, I've changed. This part was funny. She was like, actually, I haven't changed. You should keep me here, which I love. They decide that her saying that meant that she'd changed, and so they're like, you're free. We're back to the Mission Impossible heist. Obviously, everything goes off fine when they get back to the castle. And then she opens her bag and it's not, the star is not in there. And she discovers that her hot guy number three has stolen the star from her. And then, of course, that's where he manipulates her into meeting with her estranged mother. And then for some reason, that goes well. And then she's like, thank you, hot guy number three. You obviously know better than me how to conduct my own personal business. The random event that was important, I guess, that the star was for goes off without a hitch. And then she and hot guy number three kiss under the starlight or something. And then that's the end. That's the Princess Switch 3.
The thing that I loved about the Princess Switched Again was that it was so very clear that Vanessa Hudgens' missed calling is playing a villain, okay? This has nothing to do with who she is as a person, okay? I'm sure she's a very nice lady.
Like, yeah, people are gonna die. It's just terrible, but like, inevitable?
And honestly, she's very smart because she has carved out a niche for herself and now she's like executive producer on this shit. Like, that's where the money is, baby. And the control, okay? And the control. So she has this character, Fiona, who's like, again, not a sister, but also looks exactly like the other two. But she is so much more fun. And it is obvious. And yes, I was high when I watched Princess Switch Switched Again. But it was so clear to even my green-filled eyes that she was having an absolute blast. Vanessa Hudgens should just be playing villains. I think that she needs to go full Disney villain, okay? Because this is where she shines. When she plays like this boring shit, like she's good, like she's fine. She's exactly the lead that you need for like a Lifetime movie, right? Like she's beautiful. She can hit her mark. She's charismatic on screen.
Like, you're perfect. You're beautiful. Them. You look like Linda Evangelista. You're a model.
But all that's required of those characters is boringness. Like, that's pretty much it. They don't want charisma. Which brings me to my next point. What the f*** is up with the blandness in all of these films? Because let me tell you, I am a connoisseur of the Hallmark, Lifetime, Netflix, Bermuda Triangle of holiday movies. And also just like cheesy rom-coms. I love this shit. I eat it for breakfast. When I say that I've seen a crap ton of these films, I mean one metric crap ton. And let me tell you, in case you weren't listening, there is a trend, there is a pattern, it is disturbing, and that is bland. Nothing displays this problem better than the Princess Switch 3 Romancing the Star. Because there are not one, not two, but three male love interests, and every single one of them is like a tall glass of warm milk. They're so boring. And they're even like pretty in a way that's boring, if that makes sense. Something that has become clear to me after years and years of watching the Hallmark, Lifetime, Netflix, Bermuda Triangle of rom-coms. They are not casting for charisma. They're not casting for chemistry. They are casting for cheekbones, which I just don't understand why. Because there are so many actors that have charisma, that have chemistry with a lot of their fellow actors. And I just don't understand why you wouldn't try just a little bit harder, just like five more minutes to like find that. You know, because that's a producer problem. That's a director problem. And it's such a widespread problem that it's making me think that it's actually a strategy. I think they're bland on purpose. Like, I think they're actually specifically turning away all of the actors that have really good on-screen charisma and that have good chemistry with their like scene partner. I think they're deliberately not casting those people. And here's why. I think it's because of the sex. I think they're trying to turn down the sexual energy
of their films so that grandma doesn't get uncomfortable. And I'm not talking just any grandma. Like, there are plenty of grandmas that are getting it on, right? Like, go for it, grandma. We love you. But there are certain grandmas, and this is the grandma that Lifetime is going for, right? It's the conservative grandma. It's the conservative family. Because I will say also, when I watched The Night Before Christmas, I did watch that with my family and my nephews. And so, like, it had to be somewhat bland, because if it was too sexy, you wouldn't want to watch it with your kids around or, like, with your family around. You know what I mean? So I think that that's what the strategy is, like, bland on purpose. Bland on demand. Bland on demand. Hire me already. Big Lifetime, big Hallmark, big Netflix doesn't want you to feel chemistry or charisma, right? They want you to be bored. So here's the thing. I once had a friend back when I lived in Los Angeles, and I was, like, so well connected. So I had a friend who was a graphic designer on, like, one of those, like, NCIS, CSI, SBU, like, one of those things, right? Where, like, they have a million spinoffs, and she was on one of the spinoffs. And it, at the time, was, like, the number one or number two show in America. And we didn't know a single person who watched it. Like, she didn't even watch it. And I remember talking to her. I was like, why is that happening? It's, like, the number one show in America. What is happening? Who's watching it? And she goes, and I think she's absolutely right. She goes, I honestly think that people turn it on and then go about their days. Like they just sit down for dinner and they're not even watching it. It's just, like, on in the background. Kind of like podcasts now. But yeah, so I think that this is how the low budget rom-com actually operates. This is the live action version of the Yule log that's just burning in the background. That's what this is. This is like a screensaver of beautiful people on the screen going on dates, ice skating, holding hands, wearing terrible wigs, and, like, holding Hobby Lobby decorations that you can probably buy and put on your own tree. I want a good movie. You know, like, I want a good rom-com, like Sleepless in Seattle or You've Got Mail or any other Tom Hanks, Meg Ryan film. Joe versus the Volcano. Like, they have great chemistry. They made several rom-coms together. And, like, each one of those movies was a good movie. Like, there's a reason why they're classics to this day. So I just don't understand, like, what is holding the Bermuda Triangle of Love back from giving us something good. Also, question mark, did Vanessa Hudgens just hire, like, three different men that she wanted to make out with? Because she makes out with three different men in this movie. I want to talk about the future of actors. So you've noticed a trend where actors are coming out with their own alcohol brands. They're coming out with their own makeup line, their own skincare line, their own whatever beauty brand. Jared Leto has his own beauty brand, okay? The reason why, first of all, is because it's more stable. And number two, I honestly think that that's where the money is. Like, unless you're in the top 1%, you're not banking multi-million dollar deals for your films. But for the most part, I would say, like, a lot of actors want more stability. And the other thing that I think that they want at this point is control. They want more power over their own career. From the very beginning of Hollywood, essentially, of the entertainment industry, studios used to sign actors to, like, their, like, stable or whatever you would call it, which is, like, an inhumane way of saying, like, they had people, like, there weren't actually talent agencies, like, in the 1920s. They had actors. I don't know why I keep saying actors, like, censors.
Censors indicate no life forms.
Actors didn't have agents. I think they were completely owned by these studios, essentially. Like, you would have a contract and then you would have to, like, pay out, like, work out that contract at that studio. So, like, you were an MGM actor or you were a Paramount actor. All of your films would be done with that studio and you weren't allowed to go outside of that studio to make anything. Like, you didn't really have any control over your career. You just kind of did the thing and you did it to death, right? And then, like, the studio could just chew you up, spit you out, which, like, they still do. But so they had ownership essentially over the actor's career. You did not represent yourself. And then over time, eventually, I think certain actors got big enough to where they were like, fuck this. I want control over my own career. And so, like, the first way that they did that was instituting, like, agents, for example. And so, like, they weren't signing on contracts directly with studios. They had an agent who would then, like, go out and find those deals and those jobs for them. They could, like, bounce around from studio to studio and, like, do different projects. And then that's kind of how it's been for decades. It's pretty much been exactly the same same up until right about the last 15, 20 years. I think without the internet, it would have stayed the same because how else are you going to have power? Like, you don't have access to your own audience if you're just in films. The one who has access to the audience is the distribution person, and that's the studio. So, like, they have the power. I think without the internet, you never ever would have had control over your career in the way that they're able to now. And so what's happening now is with the advent of the internet, people have had much more access to their audience. So for example, I was actually just reading a conversation on a post on Reddit that was about Vanessa Hudgens' wedding where they were calling her like a C-list actress or whatever. I just feel like that's not giving her enough credit for what she's done with her career. I feel like she's done a really great job because somebody right underneath that was like, okay, but this woman has made multi-millions of dollars just from like Instagram posts. In the past, a Vanessa Hudgens would not have access to her audience. She would just kind of fade away. Like, she would do her High School Musical thing and then maybe get like another like film deal, and then it would just like, if that didn't go well, like you would just never hear from her again pretty much. But now, because she's got the internet and because she can become an influencer, she has direct access to her audience. She's able to sell directly to them, so she can get sponsorships, she can launch her own brands. And then now the interesting thing that's happening that you've probably been watching over the last especially 10 years is that these actors have now become their own producers and their own executive producers, and sometimes they've started directing as well, which is not something that was really available to most people, and especially to like women and people of color. It was pretty much only like a white man's game. That this is why you're starting to see now the trend of these actors starting to like take on more responsibility on the business side. You're kind of at the mercy of like what else is already out there. Does the studio like you? Does that director like you? There's a whole bunch of things that are just out of your control. When you then take control and you're the executive producer or like the director, you're sourcing your own projects, maybe even writing your own projects. What I really respect about Vanessa Hudgens is that she has taken what was relatively mild fame, level of fame that was really only within like a specific subset of fans, like the High School Musical crowd. And she has now turned that in to making millions of dollars a year. And like, she doesn't have to be an A-list actress. In fact, maybe she doesn't want to be. She seems to be fairly happy. Like, she just had a really expensive looking wedding. We're rooting for you guys. I think that now we're actually not going to see many actors who are just actors. In fact, I think that that's kind of outdated now. Like, I think that that's going to be a thing of the past. I don't think it's going to be possible for the majority of actors to have a career without also having to branch out into other things, like into other businesses. That means that they're creators. It's just so interesting, like the way that we're starting to see Hollywood merge more and more with like online digital creators. And I know that I don't think that Hollywood, especially old Hollywood, is ever going to respect people like YouTube creators or whatever. But the thing is, like, who gives a shit? Because we're going to be the ones making the money, babe. All right? We're the ones with direct access to our audiences. Okay? So yeah, go off, girl. Become your own executive producer. Make your own bullshit rom-com movies. I will watch them. I will watch every single one, bitch. I'm here for you. So this is my deep dive into the Vanessa Hudgens cinematic universe, and I hope that we see way more. Supposedly, there's a fourth Princess Switch coming, and I hope to God there is a fourth twin, because that would make my life, and I hope that her accent is Australian. No, New Jersey. No, Southern. That would be amazing. She's honestly doing the most. She is doing the most. She is doing her job. She is doing the damn thing. That's hard, girl. That is hard to maintain three different characters. Like, yes, is she the best actress in the world? No. But is she doing the damn thing? Absolutely, baby. All right, that's going to be it for tonight. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. And don't drink and drive on New Year's Eve, okay? Get an Uber. All right. Love you. Bye. Boop. Do you like my Christmas lighting? That's cute, right?